I'm afraid you've already heard that verse, which is the title of my paper, The Radiance of Epiphany, Beauty and Love in the Ghazals of Hafez. Before I start, I mean, it's usual to thank the conveners for having invited me. I don't know if I should thank them, because when they invited me, I very immaturely said, oh, yes, of course. And then, you know, I plunged into Hafez again, and I said, no, what have I done? What was this idea, this strange idea? Because, as we know, so love seemed very simple in the beginning, but then difficulties arise. But then, because I had to plunge in Hafez again, even if I was trapped in his zulf, I thank you anyway. Trying to define the nature of the poet's endeavor, T.S. Eliot wrote in The Three Voices of Poetry, "The poet is occupied with frontiers of consciousness beyond which words fail, though meaning still exists." If we accept that definition, then we may say without exaggeration that Hafez is not only definitely a poet, but of all the poets, one of those who have been able to cross that frontier of consciousness beyond which words fail, though meaning still exists. Because where words fail, poetry produces such mirror images that reflect what cannot usually be imagined, bespoken, or remembered. In the same way as the mirror cup, Jam-e Jahanbin, reflects the face of the beauteous Sari, each image, each bait, and each ghazal, as successive mirror monads, reflect a whole world standing beyond the frontier of consciousness. In this paper, I wish to argue that the baits of the Divan-e Hafez hold their beauty from the reflection of the beloved in each one of them, because they reflect, both in their very form and meaning, an echo of that primordial beauty experienced by the human soul on the day of Alast. I don't translate it now, everybody knows what the day of Alast is. In turn, the very intricacy of Hafez's poetry reflects the intricacies of the experience of love. As I said, Esh asan nemuda val veli oftad mushkelha. So this, the experience of love is derived from the visual experience of beauty and the difficulty to unify the multiplicity of reality in a single discourse is at the heart of this poetry. Witness the literary and or mystical commentaries that cross references render so intricate in themselves, as it has just been said. Every time and again you have, you know, studies on Hafez telling that Hafez was inspired by Maybody, Ghazali, Sanaï, Moulavi, Saadi, etc. Because he encompasses them all in his culture and in his words. And at the same time, he cannot be reduced to any one of these. And in a way, this love is so complex, so intricate, that it cannot be said in other words than the intricate words of the Ghazal, which is a very, very complicated and refined art. And that is why what we experience when we try to explain Hafez is that paraphrase destroys, sometimes utterly destroys the meaning, as all the commentators feel it. I mean, when we come to explain it, we suddenly feel, oh, what am I saying? It's so plain compared to the resonance of the original. So the choice of poetry as the language of love is the result of this impossibility to put such experiences plainly, or rather prosaically. I was very much touched by what you said on Ghazali. True enough that it's prose, but it's more poetic than any poetry in a way. It's not because it's prose that it's prosaic. So of course, this will lead us very far to try and define what poetry is. But then the way you moved us with your quotations is enough maybe to show us how much poetry it is. So love being produced by the commotion of beauty in the beginning Any discourse on love would have to recreate the conditions of this commotion and thus take part into the universal beauty of being. Love is beautiful, as has been quoted, and God is beautiful and he loves beauty. I shall try to analyze these themes and the intricate interrelations between beauty, love, sorrow, secret, and words through the analysis of only one ghazal, because it would have been impossible to go through the intricacies of the whole divan at the same time, of course. And this ghazal is ghazal 146 in Sayer's edition, and it has already been quoted, at least the first lines of it. I'm going to quote it entirely. در ازل پرتو حسنت ز تجلی دم زد، عشق پیدا شد و آتش به همه عالم زد. جلوه ای کرد رخت، دید ملک عشق نداشت، عین آتش شد از این غیرت و بر آدم زد. عقل میخواست که از آن شعله چراغ افروزد، برق غیرت بدرخشید و جهان بردهم زد. مدعی خواست که آید به تماشاگه راز، دست غیب آمد و بر سینه نامحرم زد. دیگران قرعه قسمت همه بر عیش زدند، دل غم دیده ما بود که هم بر غم زد. جان الوی هوس چاه زنهدان تو داشت، دست در حلقه آن زلف خمندر خم زد. حافظ آن روز طرب نامه عشق تو نوشت، که قلم بر سر اسباب دل خرم زد. Which very prosaically means, in pre-eternity, the radiance of your beauty bespoke of epiphany. Love then appeared and put fire to the world entire. Your face showed up and observed that angels had no love. Angered with jealousy, it became fire and fell upon Adam. Reason wished to light its lamp at its flame, but the lightning of jealousy shined and turned the world to chaos, or turned the world upside down. Pretentiously, some wanted to contemplate its secret, but the hand of the invisible came and struck the unauthorized peeper on the chest. All the others received from destiny joy and happiness. Only our heart, full of woes, bore willfully perplexed pain. I'll have to come back on this. The celestial soul desired to plunge into the well of your chin, so it seized the locks of those curly hair. Hafez wrote the book of joy, joy of your love, on the day when he crossed out all the means that bring happiness. Well, when it's read to a European audience in French or in English, it's always so bewildering. People may say, "What does it mean? I mean, what does this poem say? It's so strange because it has so many echoes and references that to someone who is not familiar with these ideas, it may sound really strange and really far from poetry." Well, we'll have to see why it is very close to poetry, actually. And I'm going to deal with the major themes of the ghazal. The first major theme is expressed in the first words is the event that took place at a time when there was no time, dar azal. In other poems, as it has been already said, Hafez refers to this time as ruze aval, or qedam, or qadim, or ruze alast. Time is becoming here the setting for a founding event. And I'm interested in the fact that we use in Persian the preposition dar to say that. Dar azal, as if azal was both a time and a space. It happens very often that time and space be united. At the same time, it gives the idea that that time may be had the quality of her inner space. All the specialists know that the simple readers of Hafez, what the simple readers of Hafez feel instinctively, that each important word has been chosen and chiseled to bring out a whole constellation of meanings and emotions in a nutshell, so to speak. Azal is one such word that brings to the mind a whole range of religious and mystical traditions, to the heart, the emotions related to those traditions, and to the soul, echoes of a lost memory. It is generally admitted that some major events took place on the day of Azal or Alast. According to the Islamic tradition, on that day before time, before the actual creation, Khalq, in space without space, when distance had not yet been created between creator and creatures, God taught to Adam the names of things and asked the humanity to be if he was their Lord, and they answered yes. And the fact is that when they said yes, they showed very enigmatically that they were most ignorant and most unjust. By so doing, man accepted, and Hafez very often refers to that, he accepted bar amanat, the weight of the deposit, the charge, something that is on their shoulders and is so heavy to bear. It's a heavy deposit, and this sealed the fate of humanity. Bar amanat has been interpreted as love or knowledge, according to different interpreters. But I believe that for Hafez, and for the poets in general, we can say that it means love. But I would immediately add that for Hafez there is no opposition. Naming things means both knowing and loving words and things. And I would like to go back to the root of she'er to make my point clear. She'er, which means poetry, comes from a root that is has also given sha'ara, shu'ur, the understanding. And it is interesting that Shamsi Reis, the prosodist of the 13th century, who was by no means a mystic, also points to this in his Mu'jam fil Ash'ar al-Ajam. He says that she'er comes from that root, which means understanding. So poetry is a cognitive process. It's not just emotion as opposed to knowledge. Emotion and knowledge are deeply united in the act of poetry. In this ghazal, Hafez clearly connects love to a superior knowledge bestowed upon man on the day of Azal in the form of radiant beauty. Again, he never separates knowledge of truth from observe or contemplation of beauty. For him, these two ideas are closely connected and interrelated. So, در ازل پرتو حسنت ز تجلی دم زد. Now we're coming to the verb. Well, I could have just gone on 1 hour just on the first line. I try to go faster. Don't worry. So the verb here evokes the idea of a whispered secret. Again, this is so difficult to translate. Damzat. It's a beautiful word. You know, when somebody has said a poem or sang a song, you usually in Persian we say damit garm. So yeah, that your breath may remain warm. So damzadan is beautiful. There is warmth in it. There is breath in it. There is whisper in it, and there is revelation in it. So you have all these ideas in one word. And it's very interesting to say that partove hosn is a visual reality that speaks. Very strange. Partove hosn, that is the radiance of beauty, starts speaking, starts telling us something. And it's telling us something essential, of course, on the nature of tajalli. Tajalli being manifestation or epiphany, again, with the importance of connotation, because tajalli, of course, literally, it means just manifestation, what makes itself manifest. But there is a connotation of light in it. And, of course, there is a connotation of the category of jalal, of course. So you have all these Arabic roots that are produce an effect of resonance and echo, and it's all there. So on that day of pre-eternity, a secret was both seen and told. Beauty, or the attribute of the Creator's face, was revealed, and the secret of its manifestation was suggested. Damzad is, well, more of a suggestion. This event, told in terms of dazzling light, with words such as parto, tajali, atash, is this event is the primordial event that triggered love, and the whole creation, olam, which again is related to a root that means what both that has given both knowledge and what is visible. Olam is what is created, what is visible. So the whole of creation is a result of this first manifestation, but only man was directly struck by it. Or stricken, you say? Stricken by. Again, the Islamic tradition says that God himself wanted to reveal his beauty in order to be seen and loved. I was a hidden treasure, and I wanted to be known. Another idea related to the theme of Alas is that the angels could not know the hidden treasure because by nature they could not stand the weight of this deposit, Amonat. And of course, this makes the superiority of man over the angels, although Hafez says elsewhere that Tofele Hastiye Eshrand Adami Opari, humans and angels alike are tiny importunate specks of the being of love. All creatures are indeed produced by love, but this does not necessarily mean that they can understand the nature of love, and even less achieve union with the beloved. For human beings, the problem is that by accomplishing the Seyre Nuzuli, the descending process of which Dr. Pujavadit spoke before. So by accomplishing the Seyre Nuzuli, the mind and the heart have usually lost the memory of the advent of beauty and of the advent of love. The problem is that by descending on earth, descending into the body or into the material world, the memory has been lost because a veil has been put between the clear soul, the soul that was there and could testify if it was asked, and of course the norm or the ordinary consciousness. And the whole purpose of the Seyre Soudi, so going up again, is to go back to this to that state of the soul that allowed the contemplation of beauty. The soul has the potential because he has received the gift, but then he has to develop it again in the Seyre Soudi. And this, of course, Seyre Nuzuli and Seyre Soudi allude also to another Quranic verse in which it is said that we are from God and to him we shall return. So only some privileged souls marked by destiny, Qur'ay Qismat, says Hafez, have kept in their memory the images of that day and can narrate them in terms of vision. Usually we forget, but some elected souls, of which apparently Hafez is, remember that day, and they remember at least something of the beauty they have seen. And the whole process of poetry is there to tell us about this event which we have forgotten, but of which he wants to remind us. I would like here to insist on the idea that this may account for the choice of the takhallus Hafez. It is usually said, and it is certainly true, that the takhallus of Hafez, his pen name, Hafez, comes from the fact that he knew the Quran by heart, and he was allowed also to read it and to say it aloud by heart. He had kept in his memory the word of God. Apparently, it also meant that he knew music, according to the recent studies of Homan Atek. She apparently has found some evidence that Hafez is also related to the fact that he had memorized the modes of music, and this may be possible too. But we could also add to this that Hafez may be the one who remembers, the one who has kept the memory of what happened in Azal, since Hafez means the one who keeps and also the one who remembers. So both ideas could be there. Well, maybe I will have some denials of this, but I'm ready to hear any denial, of course. Remembering also means being aware of Bore Amonat. Thus, we are led to the notion of Qam as opposed to Eish and Delechoram. So the word Qam, which is recurrent in the poetry of Hafez, is something which he takes as a gift, I would say, a gift of destiny. And again, I have tried to see what were the connotations of this word. It is, of course, it means sorrow, pain, but also in love poetry, longing, the fact that you long for the beloved who is absent. But if you look into the Arabic dictionaries, you see that the root also can mean perplexity, which is very strange. I'm not saying that here it means perplexity, but I'm saying that there may be something of that in the echoes of the word too. And of course, Qam is opposed, as I said, in this particular poem and in many others, to Eish and Delechoram. Eish meaning precisely the fact of being joyous, but joyous because you don't know about the realities. You know, someone who is Ayash, you know, he likes to have, you know, to go wine drinking and living in happiness without being conscious of the Bore Amonat, of that terrible deposit that has been given to human beings on the day of Alast. And in the first ghazal of the Divan, we have this incredible line, and particularly the reference to those who don't know because they are free. شب تاریک و بیم موج و گردابی چنین حائل کجا دانند حال ما سبکباران ساحل ها. That is absolutely beautiful. سبکباران ساحل ها. How can we translate this? Please help me. But you know, those who are
very few burdens that dwell on the seashore. In other words, those who are not weighed down by lots of worldly and material possessions.
Oh, I would say the contrary. Those who don't have the burden of Bore Amonat. Absolutely, they are this. It's very difficult because again, it's sometimes I just give up translating because it's difficult. But sabuk baran sahel ha means those who are light in the meaning that they don't have the burden, they don't feel the burden, but it's negative. They should feel it, and that's why they are just they stay on the shore of the sea. They cannot go into the sea. So and the sahel ha is a plural, so they are the light-hearted in a negative sense, huh? The light-hearted ones who are on the shore of the seas, on the shores of the sea, plural. Okay, so they are, in a way, in this plural, and we will have to come back to it. They are lost in multiplicity because they don't have on them, on their shoulders, the burden of unity. But we'll have to come back to it. So they don't worry. To put it in a nutshell, they don't worry about the love and beauty. So both love and knowledge are part of this Bore Amonat, and they bring pain, sorrow, and longing. To know the distance, to be aware of what has been lost, or to desire the day of union, all these stem from the consciousness of the value of love and of the value of the lost beauty of the beloved. But this is not the only meaning and implication of Qam. Longing is an essential and central theme in the whole tradition of love literature, either profane or spiritual. And this is because no desire is possible without separation, loss, and absence. Love and longing are concomitant and necessary to each other. And here I would maybe just quote from Shams, who said to Maulana, he told him, I had to go when he first disappeared. He says in substance, I had to go away because you had to experience longing. And if I hadn't, had I not gone away, you would not have make this progress towards love through the experience of longing. So it's an absolutely necessary step to experience longing in order to proceed towards love. That is why the one who has seen the primordial beauty and been love-stricken is already غم‌دیده. Very interesting. Hafez says, دل غم‌دیده ما بود که هم بر غم زد. Very strange. He made the effort of being, of acquiring غم, whereas he was already غم‌دیده. غم‌دیده is a very beautiful expression that means someone who has already seen or experienced غم. He knew غم, and then he has to look for غم too. Why? Precisely because what he has seen has sealed his destiny and has given him غم from the beginning. Seeing beauty means seeing longing, experiencing longing. Because of course you can never, never encompass it all. So he bears longing, he wants longing. Ham bar gam zad means really he wants to have it. It's an effort. There is an idea of an effort to obtain it. And I will not develop this now because it has been very well done this morning. Here, of course, we could refer to the whole Majnunian tradition. Majnun is, of course, the ideal lover because he knows what longing is. Precisely, whatever he does is ham bar gam zadan. He really, really does his best to obtain gam. Because, you know, Majnun had all the required quality to become the husband of Layli. There was no problem. He creates all the problems himself. Because, of course, if he had obtained Layli, he would not have become Majnun. He would have stayed very plain Qais, which would have been much less interesting, of course. Because his original name is Qais. Majnun is just a nickname that means the mad one. So thus, the numerous lines that allude to the centrality of longing and the paradox of joy in pain always refer to the idea in the whole divan that gham is a necessary part of love and is a necessary part of joy too. For example, we can just quote one of those lines. حافظ گم شده را با غمت ای یار عزیز اتحادی است که در عهد قدیم افتاده است. And this, of course, confirms what I have just been trying to show. حافظ گم شده را بر غمت یار عزیز. There is a union between Hafez, the lost one, and غم, and the longing for you. And this union between Hafez and Qam have been tied precisely on the day of Azal, in pre-eternity. By considering the tradition of Qam in love literature and in the story of Majnun as it has been developed by Nezami in particular, we understand that the function of Qam is not only to keep desire alive but also to burn the ego or the self of the lover, to polish him from whatever is not the beloved. And whatever is not the beloved is, in this precise poem, asbab dil khurram, the means that makes you happy, but happy with something else than the beloved. So at a certain point, when the lover has been burned, has been polished, he can again reflect in his heart the lost image of the icon of beauty. Because if he doesn't polish his inner reality, he will never be able to recover the lost image of pre-eternity in himself. And the second major theme of the poem is, of course, the question of the relationship between beauty and love. I would like here first to begin with a quotation by Ruzbehan Baghli. He says, quote, O beloved, beauty cannot stand to be imprisoned in solitude. All its desire is that love be conjoined to it, because in pre-eternity beauty and love made the covenant of never being separated. So he puts it quite clearly that you cannot separate the two themes. Beauty and love are always concomitant and interrelated. In this poem by Hafez, the addressee of the poem is a you, Pertove Hosnat, the only clue we have, that never appears as such, I mean, as such that it's never the subject of a verb. Except in so it only appears as two possessive enclitics at, Hosnat, Rochat, and also two pronouns again used as possessives, eto, your. You is never the subject of any verb, but some aspects of this you become active in a rather intensive way, I would say. He doesn't say you, but he says partov hosnat, eshq, rokh, barq ghayrat, dast ghayb. All these are elements of the you, which is not directly addressed, but which appears under such strange forms. And each time, the verb in question contains an element of violence, either visual or physical. Should I remind you that the rhyme of the Ghazal is zad. Zad, of course, in compound sometimes, but zad means strike. Thank you. Light and destruction or rejection are the two means of action of the beloved, manifested in different forms. You know, he's a fire, he's a lightning, but he always does something that zad strikes. And of course, this is enhanced by the idea, the notion of jealousy. Again, this is a rather weak translation for qirat. Qirat, there is jealousy, exclusivity, sense of honor. The dark side of the lover, I would say. And even a tint of cruelty. So the verbs used to describe his actions are put into relief by these different processes. And of course, Hafez is here consciously playing with the classical topos of the cruel and exclusive beloved, the beloved that rejects the lover sometimes and hides itself either in fire or in darkness. Because of this topos, which we know, this cliché, we may argue that Aql and Mudda'i, the victims of the beloved, may be just some aspects of the lover himself. Hafez is too delicate a thinker and too profound a poet to be so self-centered as to think that he knows something that Digaran don't know. I very often wish to see in his Aql Mudda'i aspects of the inner self, actually, more than, you know, any judgment on those who don't see. There is deep within the soul the remembrance of that radiant beauty beheld on the day of Azal. But if it is considered with the eyes of reason, our own eyes of reason, or with the pretension of a swollen ego, this beauty cannot be remembered and cannot be seen. It is too radiant, and its very radiance is burning for immature or unadapted eyes. In his commentary of this Ghazal, Khorramshahi explains that the word tajalli has been used twice in the Quran, once as the tajalli of the day, and another time in the story of Moses, who wanted to see God, but when God manifested himself to the mountain was destroyed and Moses could not stand even this indirect vision or effect of tajalli. In a way, Bar Amanat fell on the mountains. This may be related to the fact that it is said that Bar Amanat was proposed to the mountains and they refused it. So there, tajalli on the mountain destroys the mountain. And that is maybe why man to accept such a thing had to be ignorant and unjust. Ignorant, not knowing what it meant, and unjust to himself by bounding himself to making himself imprisoned into this relationship which is so difficult to bear. So the word tajalli is here a key word again and gives the poem its aesthetic tonality. The idea of light, blinding light, is omnipresent through such words as I have quoted before, and it characterizes beauty as pure light. If it is impossible to behold, it is because of its dazzling quality, exactly as love is impossible to experience without the intermediary of vision, because of its fiery nature. A direct access either to beauty or love means necessarily annihilation for any creature except for the human soul that is of the same nature. But as long as the soul is in the material realm, it needs to return to the vision of beauty progressively. And again, I will not develop here, but you all know the Platonic theory of the progressive beholding of light. You know, you cannot just look at the sun directly. You have first to look at the reflection of the stars in the water, and then the stars themselves, and then the moon, and then possibly the sun, when the eyes has get used to the gaze of light. The beauty and the intricacies of love evoked in the poem, those mushkelha, the difficulties, as well as the beauty and intricacies of the poem itself, are an introduction to the vision of beauty and the reality of love. The importance of vision is very often insisted upon by Hafez, who considers that beauty and love cannot be considered with any eye. For example, in Ghazal 441, چو مستعد نظر نیستی وصال مجوی که جام جم نکند سود وقت بی بصری. If you're not gifted for vision, don't seek union, for the cup of jam is no use if you have no visual penetration. Jam Jam would need a whole conference for itself, of course, but just briefly, Jam Jam is the cup that reflects the world. And very often it stands for the heart that also can reflect the world. This poem of Dar Azal many times appears itself as a Jam Jam, as does the heart, even if Jam Jam is not mentioned directly. All these are mirrors in which to behold the primordial scene of the apparition of beauty and love. The word peidashut means appears, but at the same time became visible. Here we would need a commentary, of course, of the Jam Jam poem, of the Jam Jam, what I call the Jam Jam poem, one of the Divan's Shah Ghazals that is closely connected to this one. Salha dil talab Jam Jam az ma mikard, anche khod dasht bigane tamanna mikard. Year after year, the heart claimed us the cup of jam, what it had itself, it asked to foreigners. But I will not go into that because I have no time. It's another story, but then it's the same story. So they are closely related, these two poems. Anyway, I come back to my to this one. So opposed to Modda'i or Namahram, which is the same foreigner, the Bigane, the one who is outside the story. So opposed to Modda'i, the Modda'i who wants to come to Tamashagah Raz, there is, of course, the person who can see, who has the eyes that see. And again, this word Tamashagah Raz means a lot, because Gah is literally a spot. Tamashagah means the place where from which you can see. So to come to Tamashagah Raz means to arrive at a spot or at a point where you can look at this scenery, which is the scenery of secret. Quite interesting. You can see a secret. In the beginning of the poem, you had a vision, an image, an icon that spoke. And now you have Modda'i who wants to come and look at a secret. There is so the suggestion of a perspective. And when you are muddai or namahram, namahram is the person who has no right to see a woman unveiled. So he has no right to look what should be remain a secret or veiled. That is the beauty of the woman. So if you are a muddai and a namahram, well, you cannot even go to that spot from which you can see the secret. It's forbidden. It's forbidden because you potentially you can't see it. If you are not mahram, well, you have to marry the woman to be able to see her. So, you know, you really need to change your status if you want to become mahram. It's concealed. There is something there that's concealed. The memory itself is a secret. I mean, the scene of beauty is a secret in itself. Hafez is not only the one who remembers the secret of Azal, he's also the one who keeps the secret by not revealing it bluntly. So Hafez may also mean that. And again, to prove my point, I will just quote from the Jam-e Jam poem, where he says that آن یار که از او گشت سر دار بلند جرمش این بود که اسرار هویدا می کرد. Alluding to Hallaj, he says that companion who was hanged was hanged because he told clearly, he revealed the secrets that he should have concealed. And maybe this is a clue. That is why Hafez does not tell things directly. That was my question this morning, which still remains a question. He doesn't give us the ultimate clue because it would be an immature unveiling. He's not going to unveil bluntly as Hallaj did, because if he did that, maybe he would put us in front of a scene for which we are non-mahram. So first, we have to become mahram. We have to develop the vision. We have to develop the eye. And all the intricacies of the ghazal as genre, in the whole genre, not only in Hafez, are in a way of exercising one's mind, one aesthetic eye, one's soul, one's emotions, one's approach, one's understanding, one's etc., etc. It's all a whole process where we exercise all these faculties in order to approach something that, of course, has the nature of a secret. And that's why I think the reading of a ghazal necessarily brings out thousands of questions. Who is speaking? To whom? Where? When? Where are we? Utter perplexity is part of the pleasure when reading a ghazal in general, and a ghazal by Hafez in particular. Gilbert Lazare speaks of an enigma, a sensation of vertigo, and the apparent disparity of the baits enhances this feeling of a kind of ununified aesthetics, non-linear aesthetics, and gives the impression of a certain lack of unity. That's why it has been said that Hafez's verses are orient pearls at random strung, and yet there is unity in a very oblique way, in the same way as the primordial vision of beauty and the all-encompassing experience of love constitute the founding principles of creation and the secret unity of being. The same aesthetic structure presides over the structure of the ghazal. It seems extreme, upside down, unconnected, even chaotic, but the unifying thread is always the paradoxical reality of love and beauty. Because beauty cannot be contemplated as such, as a whole, it has to be evoked in details. This we call in medieval French literature the art of the blason, which apparently has no equivalent in English. I've looked for it. But it means that each detail of beauty becomes an icon, an emblem in itself. We never have a whole description of the beloved. Can he be represented? We only have details that are classical and emblematic, as you said. The eye, the mole, the hair, the face, the lips. And we could here also ask Ahmad Ghazali to help us in this when he explains that each of these details represents a station or a state of love. So that's why it, it, it's not a whole. You cannot just encompass beauty or love as a whole. You have to go into details and station by station arrive to the final stage. So details become central and hold around them a whole universe that cannot be visualized as such. Apparently, I will have difficulties arriving to join Elvi, but never mind. In our Ghazal, beauty is evoked mainly as a burning fire and is associated with pure light. The only physical detail borrowed from the poetic canon of beauty are Chah Zanakhdan and Zorfe Khamandarkham, so the well of the chin, the pimple of the chin, and the hair with all its locks. And this is in radical opposition with the theme of light evoked before. In addition, the classical image is here reversed. Usually the hair is used to come out of the well in classical literature. Here, even in Hafez usually, here it is used to go into the well. He wants to go there, just deep down in the well. Because the celestial soul, Joine Elvi, the very soul that has witnessed the apparition of beauty in the form of light, desires the pimple. Havas is an impulse. Oh, I want to go there. I want to see what happens in the well. But then, you know, it's very strange because it has been able to behold beauty in its pure form, and then he wants to go into the well of the Zanakhdan. Why? Symbolically, the soul then wanted to come down to make that Seyre Nuzuli and experience the dark side of beauty, or maybe to find shelter from fire, as has been said just before. Indeed, the beauty of the beloved can be classified into two major categories, luminescent and dark, and the opposition between the two is a part of beauty. Dark hair and shining face, for example. And here, there would be much to say about the Leylian tradition in which precisely Leyli is the night, but she is, strangely enough, a light in the night, whereas Leyli means the night. So there is this two-sided aspect of beauty. Well, I think he crossed out the means for happiness. I'll cross out what I had to say about the Book of Joy, because it's a long story too. I would just like to finish on the idea that by quoting my father, who was my guide in reading Hafez before Professor de Fouchécourt, when I was just a child, he used to read Hafez to me. And before I came here, he said, he told me, well, read Hafez, love him, contemplate its beauty, listen to his music, do whatever you want. You are even allowed to speak about a ghazal by Hafez. Whatever you do, there is something you should never do. It is khod Hafez bini, that is, to see yourself in Hafez, which is, of course, very difficult, because what Hafez presents to us is a mirror, is a jami jam. But I suppose what he means by that is that we have to interiorize the cup of jam instead of looking at it as Narcissus looked at himself. Thank you very much.